Hey, what's going on, roleplayers? It's the Bard here, and welcome back to the corner. So I know I've been away for a while, but the break has really done me some good, and now I'm itching to get back into some content creation. So let's jump back into the Unconventional series and try out some new ideas for an unconventional fighter. So for anyone that saw my fighter analysis video not all that long ago, you'll remember that I thought the samurai class didn't really hold up, especially when compared to some of the other fighter archetypes. Not only was the archetype lacking in practicality, it also seemed to be lacking in the actual spirit of what it was trying to achieve. Personally, I feel the archetype could have been so much more. I'd like to explore some of the artistry of the swordsmanship, as well as some of the elegance and the culture of the ancient Eastern warrior. Iaijutsu, the art of drawing the sword, is one of the Japanese martial disciplines in the education of the classical warrior. It's a combative sword drawing art, but not necessarily aggressive, because it's also focused on counterattacks. Some research suggests that the term jutsu is study of or practice of, and is martially effective. I like this idea for this character because it's a character that's devoted themselves to the study of the blade. I see this character build as a blend of Battle Master and the College of Swords, martial mastery through your fighter levels, and the elegance and performance offered by the Bard. For this character in particular, you should put some thought into your background. If you're looking to go more down the samurai route, then you could go with Noble. If you're looking at more of a Ronin character, that is to say, a samurai without a lord, then maybe Charlatan or Urchin can give you the skills that you require. Or perhaps you simply wish to be a practitioner, someone who takes up the art for the skill and mental discipline that it requires. The Entertainer's skill package might suggest that every technique is an intricate and choreographed movement, whereas the Guild Artisan may have been the one to forge his own blade and then have taken it up as a matter of necessity. Going back to the idea of being a practitioner of the sword, I think that perhaps parry and riposte are must-haves when it comes to your battle maneuvers. While Iaijutsu is based on drawing of the blade, that can't really be represented very well with 5th edition rules, but you can focus very heavily on the turning aside of an attack and the counterattack that follows. I think I personally would include menacing attack. I like the idea of staring down one's opponent in an honourable duel. On the other hand, however, you may prefer to strike multiple foes with a single blow, so perhaps something like sweeping attack would suit you better. Also, the College of Swords has the Blade Flourish abilities, which add to your prowess as a melee combatant. Defensive Flourish adds to your AC, making ripostes easier. Slashing Flourish allows you to hit multiple targets, and Mobile Flourish is good for putting some distance between you and your target if things start to get overwhelming. A swordmaster such as this should ever be on the lookout for danger. So with a feat like Alert giving you +5 bonus to initiative, the ability to not be surprised whilst you're conscious, and other creatures not getting any advantage on attack rolls as a result of being hidden from you, then there really isn't a better pick. The lucky feat really lends itself well to the mastery of the sword as well. In situations where you don't have an advantage, you can still gain an additional dice which you can use for a better strike on your opponent. Also, you can use your lucky dice in order to make an attacker have 2 rolls and then force them to pick the lower one, which can help with your ripostes and counterattacks. I probably butchered the pronunciation of Iaijutsu, and for that I apologize. But nevertheless, I really wanted this character to be a good starting point for some of the more intricate techniques that a character with a martial background could attain. From this starting block, it's definitely worth leveling up enough to get the extra attack bonus. Additionally, you may want to look into some of the more mythological aspects as well, if you don't want to be a completely reality-based character, so you may even look into something like the only possession, for example, which might justify you taking a few levels in Warlock. Be sure to allow the character to change and evolve as you progress in levels, because such dedication to training offers a path to enlightenment. From real history now to cinematic history, the Predator is an iconic villain which is instantly recognizable. So why wouldn't you want to play this amazing apex hunter? There are a lot of interesting options that you could use for your character race, but I honestly think that Half-Orc is probably as close to the mark as you're going to get. The description for Half-Orc says that it has greyish pigmentation, sloping foreheads, jutting jaws, prominent teeth, and towering builds, standing between 5 to 7 feet tall and usually weighing between 180 and 250 pounds. So Half-Orcs have the presentation down, but it's not just the cosmetics of it. Some of the abilities that they get really fit the actual predator archetype. So, for starters, they get dark vision. There's your pred vision right there. They're obviously menacing and intimidating, which is a skill that they naturally get. The relentless endurance is perfect because they are difficult to put down, and the savage attacks speaks for itself. Orc is a harsh, grating language with hard consonants. It has no script of its own, but is written in Dwarven script. Are you guys ready to have your minds blown? Dwarven script. Predator script. There you have it. Predators are just intelligent space orcs. Alright, let's get this back on track. So for your progression, I'm looking at about 8 levels of Eldritch Knight, and then you could multi-class a little bit later with a couple levels of either Rogue or Ranger, depending on your preference. I want the Eldritch Knight class for two reasons. Primarily because it gets access to its spells, and the other for the weapon bond, which I think is going to be quite important when it comes to building this character. You can get similar effects by multi-classing early, but because this is an unconventional fighter video, I want the primary focus to be the fighter levels. So for your Predator Plasma Caster, you're going to want some kind of decent ranged energy attack, so I see Firebolt as being a perfectly valid choice. Later on, you're going to want that stealth, so invisibility is naturally going to be the spell of choice. Considering the fact that at levels 8, 14, and 20, you can choose any spell outside of the initial ones that you're given, you have to wait until level 8 in order to get hold of invisibility. On your screen is a selection of potential predator weapons that you might want to wield. So you've got the dagger, you've got the classic spear, and my personal favourite, the disc. But there are also other options that aren't shown here, such as the claw or the net, for example. Therefore, when it comes to selecting your feats, you might want to pick one or two things that you specialise in. Even if you want to carry everything, it might be worth just being particularly good at one specific thing, especially if you're going for a particular type of predator. There's a wealth of difference between a hunter predator, which you might see in the first film, as opposed to a warrior predator, which is armed differently for the second movie. Alert is an amazing feat for any kind of hunter, so it's definitely worth considering. If you're going down more of the warrior route, you might want to wield the predator spear like a quarterstaff, so it could be worth considering something like Polearm Master. For those of you who want to be more of a hunter, then Skulker is definitely on the list. Darts make a very good proxy for your disc weapon if you're looking to specialise in that. Thus, as a ranged weapon, it benefits from the sharpshooter feat. Sharpshooter can negate the disadvantage from a long-range attack roll, considering darts don't have amazing range anyway. But even so, you might not always get advantage from attacking from a hidden position. It's always just up to your DM. This is part of the reason I wanted Eldritch Knight for this particular character, because the weapon bond allows you to call weapons back to you, so once you've thrown your disc, a quick bonus action later, and it's back in your hand. If you do happen to miss your target, at least your position won't be revealed due to the Skulker feat. Also remember that invisibility breaks when attacking, so don't rely completely on it at the expense of your stealth skills. Okay, so prepare yourselves for another terrible pronunciation. So, predators on the home world are referred to as Iaijutsu. But the less honourable ones, those that use dirty tricks, more technology, attack in waves rather than in single combat, that kind of thing, are referred to as Hishkuten. At least that's the general gist of it from what I can gather. You might want to consider something like Spell Sniper, and concentrate more on the spell aspect of your Eldritch Knight, because in this respect you're having lots of long-ranged combat, particularly with things like cantrips, which then allow you to attack safely from a distance. So if you want to go down that more dishonourable route, then perhaps Spell Sniper or maybe considering something like Warcaster would be ideal for that Hishkuten style of Predator. Some of the terms in this have come out of a book called Predator Forever Midnight, which sounds like it could be a lot of fun, so I might keep my eye open for that. Additionally, there's something else that I wanted to mention, and it's not just for this particular character build, but it's also in general terms as well. So perhaps you want to consider having multiple different armor sets, maybe at least two, one that doesn't give you any disadvantage when it comes to things like stealth and hiding, and possibly a heavier armor set for when you know you're going into a toe-to-toe battle. Players tend to arm themselves accordingly when it comes to D&D combat, but I've never ever seen anyone put that same consideration into their armor. If you know you're going into a stealth situation, then you want to have an armor that's not going to give you any disadvantage on your stealth. If, on the other hand, you know you're walking onto a battlefield, then it's time for you to then get suited up with that heavy plate. Our third unconventional fighter for this video is the Grenadier. This character focuses on mobility, getting up close into the enemy lines, and then controlling the combat with a variety of alchemical equipment and various adventurer's tools. The bare minimum you'll need for this is 3 levels of Battle Master, but you'll probably want a few more than that because you want access to those extra feats. Once you've got your fighter levels, the option's there then for you to move into Rogue or Ranger if you want, but you don't have to necessarily do that. You may wish to progress purely in fighter levels, although there are certain benefits to moving into the Thief archetype from the Rogue class, for example, because then you get access to things like second story work, which is useful for climbing, and then you also get access to fast hands, allowing you to use certain objects with a bonus action. There's also options there for magical characters, but I would like this particular build to be a purely martial character. The Grenadier can actually do damage, but your main focus is to be a non-magical battlefield controller. That is to say, you want to make use of things like pushing attack and trip attack in order to put conditions on your enemies. When throwing things like alchemist's fire, vials of acid, vials of holy water, or even flasks of oil, they count as improvised weapons. Your battle maneuvers typically require you to use a weapon attack, but improvised or not, they can still be used in conjunction with each other. Your battle maneuvers such as pushing attack and tripping attack set up the conditions that you want on the targets, whereas your evasive footwork allows you to get to a close but defended position where you can better make use of the tools at your disposal. When it comes to feats, speed is everything to the Grenadier. Mobile is one of your best feats because it gives you a 10-foot bonus to speed, as well as an option to help overcome some difficult terrain, which is the absolute bane of the Grenadier character. Tavern Brawler is another necessary feat, mostly because you want the proficiency with improvised weapons, but additionally, since you're going to be up close, the bonus to Constitution can help give you some extra hit points. Also, if you do end up in a melee, you're the kind of character that usually throws their objects and items away in order to control the battlefield. This can leave you empty-handed. At least then you'll have a moderately powerful unarmed attack, and of course then you can combine that with your mobile feat, so once you make the attack, you won't be provoking any attacks of opportunity when you then move away. This character is very basic to build. It's not really difficult to make, but you have to be careful in how you move and the attacks that you're making, and you also have to consider things like item management, when and where to use your best items. Once you've been on a few adventures and you've got money to burn, if you'll excuse the pun, then you can start getting things like Alchemist's Fire and Vials of Acid. In the early levels, however, flasks of oil are still fine. You can ignite them in the same turn if you use your Action Surge, so if you're absolutely desperate, there's always that option. Also carry things like darts. You're a throwing character, so make use of those too. Just for the fun of it, however, there's a few other things you can do with this character. So, who can tell me what this is? For those of you that are familiar with it, perhaps I'll see you next time I'm in Estera. For those of you that aren't, consider yourselves lucky. Now, I'm not even going to try to pronounce this thing's name because we've all seen how badly that's ended. Moving on, however, this thing has earned the nickname of the B-52, and I will show you why. As you can see, this thing likes to fly around, dropping explosive scales on you as merrily as you please, without a second thought for what it costs to purchase the items you need to prepare for this battle. Some of you viewers may remember one of my previous unconventional builds, which was the pint-sized paratrooper. You could take a character with a small size, give them a few levels of ranger, and fly them in on top of a pteranodon, and then you could use Featherfall to parachute down into a drop zone. Well, if you want to become your own little B-52, why not just do the same thing? Take a small character, add a few levels of ranger, beastmaster, grab yourself a pteranodon, take to the skies, hurl alchemical fire at your enemies, incinerate your target, and fly off, leaving a blazing trail behind you. So there you have it, guys. Three new unconventional fighters for you to try out in your games, modify and make your own. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that and you'll at least consider giving it a thumbs up. Also, there's a comment section if you've got any ideas of your own. What do you want to see in the next video? Do you perhaps want another character class analysis? I'm toying with the idea of maybe doing either Monk or Paladin, since people seem to really like those classes at the moment. Of course, there's always a bunch of other series on the channel. You know, you've got the Basement Philosophers, you've got the MK series, you've also got the Underused Monsters, the go-to tier spells. So whatever it is you fancy at the moment, or if you've got an idea for a new series, throw it at me, I'm all ears. Also, if this is your first time here, why not consider subscribing? My subscribers are the best. They have tons of great ideas and experience that everyone's just willing to share. It's a really great community here, and all of the comments and all of the subscribers is what really makes the channel what it is. I'm so grateful to everyone. Hopefully you've enjoyed this. I've enjoyed making it. And with all that being said, I will see you guys next time at the gaming table.